Hey everyone, we're excited that you joined us for service, and we want to extend an invitation to you to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. At any point in the service that you feel the desire or the tugging on your heart to make that decision, please find a host or a hostess near you, and they will direct you to one of the pastoral team that you can make that decision. We've got a change of clothes. We've got everything you need to baptize you today. If you're ready, we're ready. Here at First Apostolic Church that we have three corporate prayer meetings a week at 9:15 on Sunday morning, at 5:30 on Sunday nights, and at 7 p.m. on Wednesday nights. Please join us for a time of prayer. I know that you have personal prayer time, but there's nothing like coming together and assembling together with a church body and calling on the name of Jesus. Hey everyone, we're excited that you joined us for service, and we want to extend an invitation to you to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. At any point in the service that you feel the desire or the tugging on your heart to make that decision, please find a host or a hostess near you, and they will direct you to one of the pastoral team that you can make that decision. We've got a change of clothes. We've got everything you need to baptize you today. If you're ready, we're ready.
This place. Anybody happy to be in God's house tonight? Anybody come to praise the Lord? Isn't he worthy of every praise, every worship we can offer up to him? Amen, amen. Why don't you look to your left, to your right, greet your neighbor in Jesus' name. We want to welcome all of our guests. So thankful for you to be here tonight with us to worship God. I know those many churches you could choose, but we are thankful that you chose to worship with us in Jesus' name. Greet each other in Jesus' name.
Soul.
thankful for that. Why don't you lift your hands to heaven? Oh, and just thank him, Lord. We thank you for the victory. Oh, we thank you for the victory, Jesus.
Calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. And I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up.
Prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same.
up a praise for just a few moments on the faithfulness of our God. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, God. We praise your name. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Worship with our choir.
Come on, let's put our hands together tonight.
Doing it all again. Whoa,
God, with your worship, my life. It was made whole. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Sing, chains will fall.
In prison, shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
I'm a living witness, my life. It was made whole.
Hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Sing, chains will fall.
Chains will fall.
Every chain is broken.
Prison, shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
The sound of Jesus' name.
praise arise in this house for just a moment. Come on, the Spirit of the Lord is here. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Come on, does anybody need liberty in the house tonight? I got good news for you today. Liberty is here. The Spirit of God is in this place. Come on, without words on a screen to a song, can we lift up our hands and our voice tonight? And can we praise the Almighty God? Can we praise the God with all power? Can we praise the God with all authority? Can we praise the God with the final say? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Come on, let's clap our hands in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can stay right where you are, and I feel this was just a good segue to go into prayer tonight. Prayer, when we take up prayer requests, it's not just a ritual that this church does. We're not pressing pause on a service, but this is very much in order in God's eyes tonight. This morning, I was talking to someone here in the altar tonight, and we began to talk about faith. We began to talk about faith, and Pastor preached an incredible message of faith this morning. And as we were just talking in conversation, the question was asked to me, what is faith? What is faith? The scripture comes to mind, it's the substance and all that. So, and that's all well and good, but what is faith? So I got to studying, and I feel like it's a combination of three things. It's a combination of three things. I'm sure there's a book, and it's Faith for Dummies. If so, give it to me, and I'll read it so I can understand what faith is. But the first part of faith is, number one, you have to believe. You have to believe. Why pray? Why go to God in prayer if you don't believe that God can do something in your life? Why waste your time and waste God's time if you've just prayed it over and over again and you just simply don't believe that God can do it? So number one is believing. Number one is believing. This comes from James chapter 2, I believe, if I'm correct. But first part is believing. But then it goes a little bit further about faith. It says that the devils believe that there is one God. And it takes it a step further and they tremble. A lot of times, us apostolic Pentecostals, we have a bad rap about, you guys are just a bunch of emotionalism. That's not what we are, but what we do here for the past 28 minutes has involved our emotions. It has involved giving God something that only He deserves, which is our emotions. When our worship goes up, yeah, it does involve your emotions, but that's not it, because we've combined believing and emotions. And then the final part of faith, it talks about faith being alone without works is dead. And so there's something powerful when you combine believing in God's word and what God can do, and you involve your emotions with your belief. But then the most powerful thing about it is when you combine those two things with acting upon those two things. And when you begin to act upon your faith, you believe in God's word. You believe that by your stripes we are healed. You believe that God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And when you evolve your emotions, your voice begins to lift. Your voice begins to raise. And maybe some tears flow down your eyes. And you begin to act upon that. That's what makes faith so powerful. And so what we're about to do, we're about to involve those three things. We're about to combine belief, emotions, and acting upon those two things. Do you believe that God can answer your prayer tonight? Do you believe that your problem maybe is too big for God? I don't believe it is. If you believe God can do it, you're doing well. If you would involve your emotions in this prayer, you would lift your hands, you would lift your voice, and maybe some tears begin to flow down you. That's not an ugly thing, but that's just involving your emotions. And then when you begin to act upon that, that's what gets the power of God moving. If you have a need in this place, would you signify that with the lifting of your hands? And you begin to pray. If you believe God can do it, then pray with your emotions. And if you believe God can do it and you're praying with your emotions, then you begin to act upon it. You begin to lift your voice. Maybe it's involving jumping. I don't know if you're acting upon your faith, because faith being dead, being alone is dead. But when you involve those three things, you begin to have faith that activates the power of God. Lord, we bring to you these needs tonight. God, we bring to you, God, the need of the Arwood family, Lord. God, we believe that you can be a comforter to them. We believe that you can be the way maker in their life, Lord, tonight. God, as they are watching this evening, God, I pray that you would go to that room, Lord, and you would be the comforter just like your word says you are, Lord. God, we believe that you can comfort those who are hurting, Lord. God, you see every need that is signified by the lifting of their hands tonight. God, these people know your word. They believe in the power of your word. And God, we're evolving our emotions. We're lifting our voice. God, we're giving you everything we have. But God, right now, we know and believe that you can do it, and we act upon it, Lord. God, we go ahead and thank you for it. God, thank you for touching our need. God, thank you for moving tonight, oh God, because there is liberty in this place. If you believe that God has heard us, if you believe that God has heard our faith tonight, would you clap your hands in this place? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And someone say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, you would return back to your seats. And if you would remain standing with me for just a few more short moments, we are going to go to the Lord and praise him with our offering this evening as our ushers are making their way forward. Just one short announcement here. In a few weeks, it is actually Easter weekend, and this starts on April 14th and 15th. FAC Maryville is privileged to host Tri-State Youth Retreat. That will be beginning each Thursday night and Friday night at 7:30. And you don't want to miss those nightly services. We will be blessed with the ministry of Pastor Sean Garnett is going to be with us. He is going to be preaching with us. So let's take advantage of that. As we just may make it an Easter revival, and we're going to have a great time in the Lord Thursday evening and Friday evening, April 14th and 15th. And then also on Good Friday, that is April 15th, starting at 10 o'clock, we will have a morning service as well. And Brother Joseph Perez, which is our Section A youth director, he will be preaching that service on Friday morning. And something unique that will take place Friday morning, we are having a panel discussion with three very successful businessmen that are very much apostolic. And this is going to be awesome because they are going to be teaching the youth of the Tri-State and our youth and whoever wants to come that Friday morning on the spirit of apostolic entrepreneurship. That took me a lot of manure. I hope I said that right. And hopefully there's no manure in entrepreneurship. Anyways, but they're going to be speaking on that. And because we realize as apostolics, we realize that we are an extension and we are the church in the book of Acts. How many believe that? How many believe that? And so if we believe that, we understand that there is no such thing as a secular job when it comes to being an apostolic. And so we're going to talk about how we need some apostolic doctors, and we need some apostolic lawyers, and we need some apostolic business people. It's just not the highest calling in the church is not to step behind this pulpit and preach, but it's to be a witness, to go out into your field and be a witness to your world. And that's what we're going to be talking about on Friday morning. That's going to be an awesome time. Again, that's April 14th and 15th here at FAC. It's going to be a wonderful time. If you got your offering in your hand, if you lift your offering to heaven tonight, let's ask God to bless this offering. Lord, we ask that you would touch us. Lord, we've praised your name, Lord, and this is not just a pause in our service, but God, this is very much a continuance of our worship tonight. God, as we praise you with our offerings this evening, God, I know, Lord, some may be of a sacrifice tonight, God, and I'm so thankful that you'll bless your people. God, our offering that would go into, God, the world mission field, Lord, and the offering that would go to further your kingdom, Lord, we do everything in your name, and we ask that you would bless it in the name of Jesus. Someone say, in Jesus' name. You can exit out of the right side of your row and give cheerfully to the Lord this evening.
Tennessee, First Apostolic Church. It's Sunday night. The Holy Ghost is real, and God's about ready to move in this place. How many believes that He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore? you're here tonight, you need something from the Lord, I'll go ahead and tell you my title already. My title for tonight's message is The Healer is in the House. There's a healer in the house tonight. I want to join up with Brother Nolan tonight about praise. Some people have said, isn't that a little much? It would be for you. Isn't that a little much? It would be for politics. Isn't that a little much? Well, it would be for a lot of things down here. But when it comes to my Jesus, can I tell you that we could have started at 12 noon today and be worshiping God as hard as we could, and it still would not be enough. Come on, if you believe that, would you give him some praise right now? There's a healer in the house. There's faith in the house. There's a God that's able to do exceedingly abundantly and above all that we can think and or ask. The altar service, the altar caller will be a little bit peculiar tonight. It'll be a little bit different. Even the message just may appear to be a Wednesday night Bible study. But I believe that if we will act on what we hear tonight, that God will perform miracles for his people. If you have your Bibles tonight, turn to Psalms chapter 107, verse number 20. The healer is in the house. I want to be a balanced pastor. I want to be a good pastor. I want to give you information about the coming of the Lord. I believe good pastors preach about the coming of the Lord. I want to be a good pastor that reminds you from time to time that there's only one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. I want to be a good pastor from time to time, tell you about holiness. Well, at least two people believe that. I don't mean to be sarcastic, maybe just a little prick there to you. But also, I want to be a good pastor and tell you that we do serve a God of the miraculous. We do serve a miracle-working God. God is still in the healing business. God is still a miracle worker. Psalms 107, verse 20. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. He sent his word and healed them. Father, I ask you tonight, as you asked Peter, you said, Peter, do you love me? Peter said, you know that I love you, Lord. And you said, feed my sheep. Lord, I want to feed your people tonight because I believe that someone in this building and someone watching online is in need of a miracle. I pray tonight, Lord, that you would anoint my mind. Help me, God, to teach this and preach this. And help me, Lord, to get out of the way at the end of the service. And let people come forward to ignite their faith in your word. Give you all the praise. I'm not a healer. I give you all the praise. I am not a deliverer. I give you all the praise. I am not the Savior. I give you all the praise because you are both healer, you are Savior, and you are deliverer. In Jesus' name, I pray tonight. Amen. You may be seated. There's a healer in the house. Say that with me. There's a healer in the house. He sent his word and healed them. We're going to speak a lot about God's word tonight because you cannot have true biblical faith without the word of God. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 20 through 22 reads like this. My son, attend to my words. Incline thine heart unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. Sound like to me that the writer there is telling his son to keep the word of God close to him. Keep the word of God close to him. He said, let my words, attend to them and incline thine heart to them and don't let your eyes depart from them. And then verse 22 gives the reason. For they are life unto those that find them and health to all their flesh. Why emphasize the word tonight in the midst of miracles? Is because the word brings life. There is life in the word of God. And not only does the word bring life, the Bible says that the word will be health. The Bible said it will be health to all of their flesh. It will be health to their flesh. We know he sent his word to heal. We know that his word has life attached to it. And not only that, his word also brings health. Notice this. His word will bring health to our flesh. Now I want to preface something for a moment. I do believe this evening that if you have got a situation in your life that you can cure, you need to cure it. Well, I'm always tired. I'm gonna come down for prayer tonight because I'm always tired. Can I ask you a simple question? Are you getting enough sleep? I read this past week that before the invention of the light bulb, the average American slept 11 hours a night. That's amazing. But since the invention of the light bulb, the average American sleeps a little less than 7 hours every night. We're told by doctors and scientists that our body needs more than that. So I'm here to tell you that there are times that if I have control of healing in my body, then I need to exercise that. I need to exercise. But I'm talking about tonight people that need miracles in their lives. Scripture says in Psalms 19 and verse 7, the law of the Lord is perfect. There is a law. There is a governing law of God. This word is perfect. What will it do? It will convert the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Can I tell you, if our lost loved ones have any hope at all, it's not in you being friendly necessarily to them and bringing them to a friendly church. Because sinners can come to a friendly church, but if the word does not convert them, they're just as lost as they were when they were in the world. Only the word of God can convert a sinner. Now it's interesting tonight when I'm talking about the word of God, because the word of God operates much like medicine operates. It operates much like a prescription that your doctor gives you about a sickness in your body. The word of God operates on a similar basis. For example, they give you medicine that you take into your body. They give you a prescription, a pill that you take into your body. That pill has all of the ingredients to correct whatever is wrong in your body. An example could be high blood pressure, There's some of you here in this room tonight that suffer from high blood pressure, and you've got medication. You've got medication with you that regulates your blood pressure. Now let me put everybody at ease tonight. I am not telling you to throw your blood pressure medicine away, because I give God glory, because it was God that gave the doctors the know-how. It was scientists and doctors that gave them the know-how for this medicine. So I am not anti-medicine. I'll go ahead and tell you that when I get a headache, I take an aspirin. All right? Because in my opinion, God has given, you say, well, you're giving glory to the doctor. No, I'm not giving glory to the doctor. They would not have had that knowledge had it not been for God Almighty giving them the knowledge for the medicine, the scientists and all that. It would be God. The medicine in God's word walk a similar road, in that medicine goes in the body, the flesh, and affects the flesh. The word, for it to be effective, must go into the mind. You have got to receive the word in your mind. You have got to discipline yourself enough to give the word of God the importance and the honor that it deserves. And says, wait a minute. I want to hear something tonight. Wait a minute. I want to hear something. Just like you would get a prescription and put that pill in your mouth. If the word is going to heal us, if the word is going to convert us, the word has got to enter into our minds. It has got to get into our spirit. Look at these two tracts tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 9. It simply says in 1 Corinthians 2 and 9, but as it is written, eye hath not seen, that's a natural eye, nor ear heard, that's a natural hearing. Neither hath it entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. So we know tonight that we're here in the flesh. Our ears are hearing, our eyes are seeing. But what we are doing in the spirit this evening is that we want to take God's word, which, have I told you, God's word is life? And have I told you that God's word is health to our flesh? And did I tell you that God has sent his word to heal us? But verse 10, but God hath revealed them unto us by his spirit. For the spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the spirit of God. So he separates one man into two categories, the human side and the spiritual side. And so there are some things in the human side you know because another man has taught you. Your parents taught you how to tie your shoes. Someone taught you how to drive a car, or we hope they taught you how to drive a car. But when it comes to the things of God, it is a different teacher. It is the Spirit of God. Verse 12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, and I can say thank God for that, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. That's why the Holy Ghost is important, and that's why being under the Word of God is important, because the Holy Ghost illuminates the Bible. The Holy Ghost illuminates your mind, and then the Holy Ghost wants to teach you what God's Word is saying to you. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things, now watch this now. Look at this progression that I'm going on. A man can teach you something, but he can only teach you by his spirit, his fallen spirit, his fallen nature. But when God begins to teach you, he teaches you on the platform of the illumination of the Holy Ghost. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. And when the Holy Ghost comes into your life, it's like a light in a room. But not only that, then the Holy Ghost words start coming from the Bible. You're being taught the Word of God. And that's the reason that we know these things. And let me go back to verse 12 again. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. So now the Word comes, the Holy Ghost comes, the Word of God comes, and then look at verse 13. Which things also we speak. So now we understand that when the Holy Ghost comes, it illuminates. And when the Word of God comes through pastors and teachers, it begins to give us our spiritual intellection. It begins to give us spiritual knowledge. But it all doesn't stay inside. We begin to speak God's Word. We begin to talk about God's Word. We begin to speak. Look at verse 13. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches. You ever notice something? Start talking about the Bible in a crowd of unconverted people. You either get an argument on your mind or an empty table before you. Because you start talking about the Word of God and an unconverted world begins to say, I don't understand what you're saying. And that's exactly right. Which things also we speak, not in the wisdom, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. You see, you got to get the Word of God in your spirit. It's not enough to get it in your natural ears. You've got to get it in your spirit tonight. It's not enough just to come and hear somebody preach on Sunday morning and Sunday night. I want to know, is it getting down inside of your heart? Is it getting down inside of your heart? Or are you meditating upon it? Are you thinking upon it? Not just hearing the sermon with your ears and letting it go through the filter of your mind to see how much you agree with it or how much you don't agree with it. For example, let me walk in the Spirit tonight. I can already tell you in the Spirit that there's those that are saying, Pastor's not very anointed tonight. I just don't really feel like this is a very anointed. And that's because you have a filter of a certain sermon that you've got in your mind that's a good sermon. You know, and sometimes kind of carnal people that sit on pews, their good sermon has a lot of comedy to it. It has a lot of jokes to it because they like to be entertained. But spiritual people don't want to be entertained. They want to receive the Word of God. That is our meat. That is our strength. I'm not making it up. The Word of God is life. That's why you can leave here and you can feel like you've got energy is because the Word of God has come in. Well, let me just ask you something tonight. Let me just ask you something tonight. Some of you brothers that get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, go to work, get off work around 5 o'clock in the afternoon, come on to the house of God. Your back's tired. Your mind's tired. You was almost tempted to go home. You've not had supper and you've not had a shower. But you come on to church anyway. You're so tired you can't hardly keep your head, you can't hardly keep your eyes open. You're nodding off. But you get in the house of God, and all of a sudden the preacher, the teacher, the Word begins to go forth. And the next thing you know, you're forgetting you're tired. And the next thing you know, you're not tired anymore. The next thing you know, you're on your feet, clapping your hands, rejoicing. Can I tell you what just happened? The Bible says the Word of God is life. Several years ago, and personally, I just believed that I was too young to have arthritis in my hands. But I had arthritis in my right hand here. My knuckles would swell up 3 or 4 times their size. And it was hard. It was so hard to close my hand. My knuckles would just get inflamed. And I was at the doctor's office and he said, it's arthritis and you're going to have to live with it. You're simply going to have to live with it. You know, I really believe that I would be living with arthritis, but I just decided that I was going to go before the throne of God Because the Bible tells us, did I not read it tonight, that the Word of God is life and the Word of God is health to, not my spirit, but it's health to my flesh. I just begin to ask God to heal my hand. I just begin to ask God to heal my hand. It didn't happen in a prayer line. It didn't happen overnight. As a matter of fact, I really can't tell you when it happened, Sister Wood. All I can tell you is that for some time I would just ask God to touch my hand and touch this arthritis. And then one morning I was having coffee with the love of my life, and it just dawned on me that I can't remember the last time my knuckles got inflamed with arthritis. And I'm telling you, this has been many years ago, and I'm giving God the praise tonight that I don't have that arthritis in these knuckles. Our God is a healer. But you got to get the Word of God into your spirit. You've got to get the Word of God into your spirit until you start talking about it. James chapter 1 and verse 21. Someone say, praise the Lord. James 1 and verse 21. You got to get the word into your spirit until you start talking about it. James 1 and 21. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Let me just break it down to you. Get sin out of your life. Now, none of us are worthy, and we should always ask God to forgive us. Even when we don't even know what we're asking God to forgive us of. Because we know that we're not perfect. And so my little prayer goes something like this. God, if I've said anything I shouldn't have said. And God, if I've done anything I shouldn't have done. And Lord, if I've thought about something I shouldn't be thinking about. Would you wash me in the blood, Jesus? Would you wash me in the blood? Now that's one thing. But if I know I've said something I shouldn't say, and I know I'm thinking about things I shouldn't think about, and I know that I shouldn't do what I'm doing, then, church, read my lips. Repent. Stop it. Quit. Turn around. Because you can't have the world and the word in the same vessel. One of them is going to take over. Stop. Repent. If you're stealing, stop it. If you're lying, stop it. Wow, he's a little straight. Yeah, stop it. If you're lusting, stop it. If you're watching things you ought not watch, stop it. But don't deceive yourself to believe that you will be a recipient of the benefits of the Almighty God living that lifestyle. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. You cannot have a word graft and a world graft. You cannot have God's word being grafted and sin being unrepented and unaddressed in your life. First Apostolic Church of Maryville, if we want the healer in our house, then we've got to be willing to have the Savior in our house. And we have got to repent. If you're fornicating, quit. If you're committing adultery, quit. If you're sexually perverted, quit. Well, yeah, it's difficult. There's nothing difficult when you get the Word of God inside of your heart and you begin to speak to sexual addictions. You begin to speak to nicotine. You begin to speak to these things. You begin to speak the Word of God. I want to be a good pastor. For we need a prayer line, we need an altar service. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness and receive with meekness the engrafted word. You know why you need to receive it with meekness? It's because your flesh don't want to hear it. Your flesh wants to balk. One of the things he'll tell you when they're going to put a needle in your arm or some other place, they'll say, don't flinch now. No, don't tighten up, woman, now. Because if you tighten up, it's going to hurt a whole lot longer. Just let your arm hang loose, preacher. I'm going to put a needle in it. I'm world's worst now. Just hang loose, because I want to squint, look the other way. Oh, when's this over? When's this over? When's this over? Can I tell you something? That when the word of God is coming, receive it with meekness. Tell your flesh to be quiet. Tell your flesh to sit down. Tell your mind, tell the thoughts that want to rise up against this tonight. Oh, I might be doing this, but oh, sister so-and-so over there, she doing that. You got to tell that thought, you sit down right now. Matter of fact, don't you only sit down, you keep your mouth shut. I'm tired of the way you've been talking to me. I'm tired of the way you've been. You've brought me nothing but death and agony and despair and defeat and depression. It's time to get the word of God inside of me and have some life and some health. Receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. And be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is likened to a man beholding his natural face in a glass. And James goes on and says, you forget what manner of man. Can I tell you tonight, I just don't want to preach a little sermon and keep you here for another half hour. I want to preach something that can be applied into your life. Jesus addresses the power of his word. In John chapter 15, verse 7, listen to what Jesus says to you and I tonight. If you abide in me, if you're living in me, and my words abide in you. Isn't that amazing? You've been filled with the Holy Ghost, and his words start abiding in you. Guess what's the next thing comes up? Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Say, man, I like that. I just ask God for anything. No. When you get the word inside of your heart, you're going to know what to ask God for. When you get the word inside of your heart, your priorities are right. When you get the word inside of your heart, you're not just saying, "Oh, I like that scripture right there because I want a fancy car and I want a big house and I want all this stuff. I want all this stuff. I'm just going to, man, I like that, Brother Carpenter." It don't work that way. It's amazing when you get the contentment of God inside of your life and you get the word inside of your life. It's amazing how shifting your priorities get. He said, ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified. Now watch this now, church. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. He's not saying you abide in me and my words abide in you and you can get the car you want and the house you want and the job you want and the wife you want and the kids you want. No, he says if you'll do that, you'll be a disciple maker. You'll be a soul winner. Listen, this church is so pregnant with souls right now. We are so pregnant with potential. We are so pregnant with potential right now. We are so pregnant with souls right now. Today, we spent the end of the service. We had a special lunch at Global Grounds for the new people that are coming in the church. They've got a brand new class of welcome to the family. And we were running around here like chickens with our heads cut off. Hey, get that new one in here. Hey, get that new one in here. Hey, go ahead and get that new one. Because quite honestly, my main priority when I come to church is not to shake saved people's hands. Oh, he don't love us. Oh, yes, I do love you. My main priority is not to shake your hand. My main priority is to scour this congregation like a panther looking for a new prey. And if I see somebody new, mighty God of heaven, it's their hand I want to shake. It's that person that I want to take it, not save people. We're so pregnant with souls right now. We're so pregnant that God is going to give us, I speak this tonight in Jesus' name, I believe God's going to give us a citywide revival. I believe God's going to give us a citywide revival. I believe that God is going to shake this city. He's going to shake people in this city. If you believe that, would you stand with me? And could we pray that God would use FAC Maryville for a citywide shaking revival, a Holy Ghost move, a power of God? Come on, church. Oh, come on, church. Hallelujah. 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 If my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and I shall give it. Jesus, I want a citywide revival. I want a revival that'll shake Maryville. I want a revival that'll shake Alcoa. I want a revival that'll shake Greenback. I want a revival that'll shake Friendsville. I want a revival that'll shake Townsend. I want a revival that'll shake Seymour. Revival, revival, revival. I want to be the biggest headache hell's had in the 21st century. I want to have revival. You may be seated. Can I ask you a question? It's a loaded question. Would God want to save everybody in our city? That's about eight of you. I said, would God want to save everybody in this city? You know, it's amazing. The only people we seem to have compassion with and for is those that disrupt our schedule. Are you really concerned about the salvation of your children? Or does it just pester you that you might have to go get them out of jail next week? Because I'm going to tell you something. If you'll take care of God's business, God will circle back around to the farm and take care of your business. But if you're only concerned with your boy and your girl and your granddaughter, God may just be telling you, good luck. If we can't be compassionate about what God, and I'm going to go at it again, is it God's will? Would it be God's will to save everybody in this city? It'd be God's will, right? I believe that. I believe that. So if it's God's will to do it, what would it take to get it done? If it's God's will, then what would it take to get it done? Let me ask you a simple question again. Kind of little questions here. In the first chapter of Genesis, you will notice that every time God spoke, creation took place. But creation was already there. It was already in the mind of God. He wasn't out there just talking and things were being created. Light was already there. It was already the Word of God. It was already hidden in the bosom of God. But light did not come into physical being until He spoke it. And when He spoke it, light appeared. Now, can I tell you tonight that whether or not every soul in Blount County would be saved is up to the free will of every person in this county. But it is the obligation and the spiritual responsibility that if they're going to deny it, they at least got to hear it. God wants every person to repent. God wants every person to be baptized. God wants every person to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. But they can't reject it or accept it until somebody speaks it. Light was already there, but Genesis 1:3. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Genesis 1:6, and God said, let the firmament be in the midst of the waters. And the firmament was there. Genesis 1:9, and God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered into one place. And it was so. Genesis 1:11, and God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed was in itself. And it was so. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for years and days and years. And it was so. Verse 20, are you seeing the connection? And God said, let the waters bring forth. And it was so. Genesis 1:24, and God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures. And it was so. Do you see the analogy? The plan was in the bosom of God, but it had to be spoken in order for it to appear. Just like our miracle could be in the bosom of God. Well, why don't I have it? And God says, why don't you speak it? Why don't you speak it? Your miracle could be in the bosom of God, but God is saying, why don't you listen when the Bible's being taught? Why don't you listen when the preacher's preaching? Where is your Bible? Where is the Word of God in your life? You handle the TV changer more than you do the Bible. You know more about channels on Charter than you know how many books are in the Bible. There's a miracle, but we've got to get it inside, and we've got to speak it. There is a healer in this house. I know I'm sharp with you tonight, but I'm here to tell you, God had that hid in his bosom, and God spoke it. And God's got your miracle in the Word, because the Word is your life, and the Word is the health of your flesh. But you've got to learn how to get it inside of your life, and you be able to start speaking that word. Start speaking that word. Can you say amen? It's a little story in Mark chapter 5, verse 24. Why don't we just for a moment before I go into this, why don't we just lift our hands and ask God to help us all tonight? Oh, the word. There's a miracle in 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 the word. Oh, there's a miracle in the word. There's a miracle in the word. Come on, church. There's a miracle in the word tonight. Oh, there's a miracle in the word tonight. I am not going to lay hands on you for you to feel a chill bump. I am not going to preach until you feel something. I want to preach until you know that the Word is alive, that the Word is able to help us tonight. The Word, the Word, the Word, the Word. I'm going to tell you, the Word will keep you going when everything else around you and your natural senses tells you no. If the Word spoke to us up on the hill and said, my coming is soon, I want you to give to missions as never before, then you know what took us through this tedious, long building program? You know what saw us through here? The Word did. And I was reminded by Sister Erickson today that we did not name this the Maryville Miracle. No one in this church said, hey, this is the Maryville Miracle. You know who named this the Maryville Miracle? The newspaper did. The newspaper did. The newspaper, when it came out, and had modern day miracle and had a picture of our church. That's the way it ought to be. It ought to be the world recognizing a miracle among us. But it was a miracle. You know how we got here in this miracle? We held on to one little phrase he told us. Give to missions and I'll take care of the new sanctuary. When God gives you a word. Look at Mark chapter 5 verse 24. Mark chapter 5, verse 24. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman, follow closely now, which had an issue of blood 12 years, hemorrhaging, losing blood. See her in your imagination tonight, is pale and weak. 12 years she hemorrhaged blood, had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. Hang with me now. Verse 27. But when she had heard of Jesus, I don't know who you are, and I don't know if we'll know who you are in eternity, but the story didn't start with the woman. Somebody had to tell that woman about Jesus. Somebody had to tell that woman about the Word. As a matter of fact, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and without the Word, nothing was made that we see. And the Word became flesh. Somebody had to tell that woman about Jesus, because it wasn't the will of God for that woman to keep hemorrhaging. There was a healer in the land, and it was the will of God for her to be healed. But she can't be healed until somebody tells her about Jesus. It's never the will of God. Listen to me, church. It's never the will of God for somebody on your job to tell you they don't want to live anymore. They are tired of living. They don't want to live. You know what they just told you? They just told you they're thinking about suicide. For the love of God and the love of souls, when you have somebody on your job that's telling you life isn't worth living, would you please tell them about Jesus? Would you please tell them that there's a healer in the house? Would you tell them, come to my church? There's something happening at my church. The power of God is in my church. Tell them about a Bible study. I don't know who it is, Brother Hammond, but somebody, male or female, told that woman about Jesus. And when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be healed, or shall be made whole. Get the analogy here, please. Someone told her about the Word. They told her about Jesus. When she heard about Jesus, she made up in her mind that she would go to him. And she began to speak it. She began to visualize it. Oh, that's what the Word will do for you. The Word will begin to paint beautiful pictures of a future inside of your mind. As a matter of fact, the Word, if you'll really pray in faith, I'm not crazy tonight, but if you'll really pray in faith, you can imagine your loved one bursting in the back doors of the church, walking down the middle of the aisle. Visualize them talking in tongues right now. Visualize them walking up. If they're a man, walking up. If they're a woman, walking up. Visualize them getting the Holy Ghost. Visualize them taking their worldly clothes off. Visualize them having a sanity of mind. That's what the Word will do. Visualize your daddy coming to church. Visualize your mama coming to church. Visualize things in your life. Visualize it. Visualize yourself with victory. Brother Mayo, did she not? She began to visualize herself until she began to say, if I could just touch, if I could just touch his clothes. That's a visualization. If I could just get my loved ones here, God could fill them with the Holy Ghost. If I could just get them in the bed, let me tell you something. If we can start stretching our mind, God wants to save everybody. Now, yes, you're correct. Well, I don't know about God saving everybody. I know it's God's will for everybody to hear the gospel. She said, if I could just touch his clothes, that's all I want to do. I just want to touch. If I could just touch his clothes, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. Not I might, not maybe. If I can touch his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt, everybody say felt. She felt. That's where God's word can bring a feeling to us. She felt in herself. She felt in herself, in her body, that she was healed of that plague. She touched the Lord. Get it with me now? She touched the Lord, and she felt something inside of her. I believe that there is a connection in faith, that when you make that connection, something you can feel that it just happens. I just know that it's going to happen. I can't explain it, but I just know that God moved tonight. I just know that God's going to make a way. The mountain's still there, but I just know that it's going to be moved. I still got these issues, but I just know that it's going to be all right. I'm still struggling with this addiction, but I just know that God's going to make a way. I just know that I'm going to be changed. I just know. Oh, listen to me tonight. Some of us young folks have heard all kind of horrible words in their mind. You're penitentiary bound. You're going to be pregnant before you're married. You ain't nothing but no good. And sad to say, some of them have lived down to that. But oh, if we can just get them in a Pentecostal apostolic youth group, if we can just get them around a Zach Hammond or a Nolan Carpenter, and they begin to tell them, you do have a future. God can do something with you. God can take a nobody, and God can turn them around, and God can make, and somehow. Somehow, a little 15-year-old boy that didn't have all the teeth in his head just began to believe God, that God could do something great with him. He just began to believe it, and God made a preacher out of him. I've come to tell somebody to speak the word tonight. I've come to tell somebody it's time to get the word in you. I just feel like something good is about to happen. I just feel like something good is on its way. I just feel like God is going to move. Come on, church, would you take it right now and give God some praise? My God, I am not trash. I am treasure. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am not the records at the courthouse. I am not the memories of the family. I am who I am. Come on, if you believe it. Come on, if you believe it, you gotta get up. You gotta get on your feet. You gotta shake yourself. You gotta begin to cry out, that's me. That's me. That's me. That's me. That's me. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. That's me. Turn to your neighbor and say, that's me. That's me. Man, let's get loose in the Holy Ghost in here tonight. That's not me. It's not the will of God. I'm going to have you be seated. I'm not done yet. I'm sorry. A little faking you off there. I've come to serve notice on hell tonight.
I've come to look some apostolic young people in the eyes that's confused about if you're going to live this or not. I've come to look some young ladies and some young men in the eyes that you don't know if when you turn 18 you're going to stay in this church tonight. But I have come to tilt the scales in God's direction and to get you to believe in you, son. Get you to believe in you, son. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. You look up here tonight. Some of you are far ahead of the game. You got way more going on for you tonight than I had going on for me. So if God could take a long-haired 15-year-old boy and fill him with the Holy Ghost and call him to preach, you know why? I just believed what they said that I could be, and that's where I'm at tonight. She felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Notice verse 30. Jesus immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And I'm going to tell you, that's a humanity side. That's a humanity side. Jesus as a man, his knowledge was limited. But as God, he knew all things. So when Jesus had that woman to touch him, the only way I can describe it's this way. You ever got a lamp in your house connected to some of the appliances in the kitchen? It can be a beautiful lamp in the dining room, all lovely. You can be in there talking to company in your nice dining room. But somebody turns the blender on, and the light goes. Why? Because something else took a power source out of. Jesus is walking around full of deity. He just walking through the crowd, people just touching him left and right. And all of a sudden, a woman who has faith in the word reaches out and touches his garment. And all of a sudden, he turns around and says, "Peter, who touched me?" Peter said, "Who touched you? Who touched you? You're in a crowd. They're thronging you. That means everybody was crowded around. Everybody's shoving you. Everybody's shoving you around. What do you mean, who touched me?" He said, "No, Peter, it wasn't a casual touch." That's what's wrong with a lot of us. We don't get changed because we come to give him a casual brush tonight. Just a casual glance tonight. We come just to rub shoulders with him or play footsie with him. But when you have somebody in the crowd, I'll take one out of 500. You take somebody in the crowd that says, "I don't want just a touch. I've got to get my healing." He said, "No, Peter." He said, "No, Peter. Somebody touch me, for I felt virtue leave me." And he, verse 32, looking around about to see her that had done this thing. And right here is the greatest thief of a miracle. Right here is the greatest thief. It's already crept in here a few times tonight. You've already had the thief come to your pew and say, "Not you." Shannon Wilson, you've already had the thief come tonight. You've just returned from Cleveland Clinic. You've already had the thief come tonight and whisper into your ear, "Not you." Kathy Belcher walking in here with an oxygen tank tonight. The enemy's already saddled up beside you tonight and said, not you. No. This is the way you're going to leave this world. You're going to leave this world because, after all, everybody has got to leave this world sometime. I understand that. But can I tell you, if I'm 99 years old and I get cancer, this 99-year-old, probably bald-headed man, is going to find himself in a prayer room. And I'm going to say, "Somebody, would you pray that I can be healed? Because I'm going to die in the faith." Some folks die out of the faith. I'm going to die in the faith. But I'm not going to die until I have no breath in my body. And until then, I'm going to say, "Why not me? Why not the arthritis gone? Why not the arthritis gone?" Come on, church. Come on, apostolics. Come on, believers. Let me show you the biggest thief. But the woman, fearing and trembling. Can I tell you what will take your miracle faster than anything? Fearing and trembling. Oh, have I done something wrong? Have I done something wrong? But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing, wait a minute, y'all just seen what I seen? What did she first say after she touched him? I feel. But what does she now say? Knowing. Can I tell you, there will be an initial feeling, but what you have to get you over the fear is knowing. I know God touched me. I know God touched me. I know, let me tell you, I know as sure as I'm standing here what happened to me over 38 years ago, right up here on the corner of William Blunt and 321, coming in town as a young evangelist, trying to get to Penny Bennett's house before curfew so that I could see her a few minutes before curfew. Coming in from Lexington, Kentucky, I preached for Brother Edgar Tietrich in Lexington, Kentucky. I know, Lori Hawkins, what happened to me when I topped that hill right there at that intersection where William Blunt and 321 goes. And all of a sudden, I saw the lights of that city. I saw the street lights, and I heard a voice as it was saying, "These are souls waiting on you. These are souls that are waiting on you." Tears filled my eyes until I could hardly drive down what now has a Weigel's and another gas station on the other side. I could hardly drive my car down, Brother Hammond, because tears was bathing my face. I left there saying, "I feel like God wants me in Maryville." But you know what? Tonight, all miracles don't stay in emotion. They go to the mind. I know God wants me here in this city. I know God had his hand. Come on. I know God wants you in the church. I know God wants your life changed. I know that. We got to get to where we speak the word. We got to get to where we speak the word, but you can't speak what you don't know. And you can't speak what you don't memorize. You can't speak what you don't know. How do you know to fight the devil if you don't know what tool you're supposed to fight him with? How do you know when that lying slewfoot comes to you and starts telling you all the things? He's a liar and the father of lies. He couldn't tell the truth if he tried to. When he comes and tells you you didn't get the Holy Ghost, what do you say back to him? Oh, yes, I did. And he says, "Oh, no, you didn't." "Oh, yes, I did. Because Acts 2:38 says, and you shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. And Acts 8 says, you shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. And Acts 10 says, you shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. And Acts 19 says, you shall be filled." And I got it. I got it just like the Bible says. He comes to some of you women and says, "What are you doing with that long hair? What are you doing with that stuff on your head?" I'm going to tell you something. If you can't put him scripture back in his face, he's going to keep on wearing you out until you speak the word over him. "Satan, I take dominion over you. Satan, I'm not afraid of you, and I take dominion over you. You have already been conquered. Jesus Christ crushed your head. You have already been defeated, and you are in a holding room right now waiting to be cast into a bottomless pit. I bind your voice from my mind. I bind your voice from my family. I bind your voice out of my life. I bind it in the name of Jesus Christ." Come on, why don't you do that? Why don't you do that with authority right now? Come on, do it with authority right now. Let me try to quit. Deuteronomy 28 and 1. Deuteronomy 28 and 1. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord God, that's the word of God, to observe and do all his commandments, that's the word of God, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God, Deuteronomy 28 and 1, will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou hearken unto the voice of the word of thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, blessed thou shalt be in the field, blessed shalt thou be the fruit of thy body, that's your children, and the fruit of thy ground, that's your labor, and the fruit of thy cattle, and the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and store. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in. Blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies to rise up against thee, to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. The Lord shall command the blessing upon thee in the storehouse and in all that thou settest thy hand unto, and he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall establish thee a holy people unto himself, as he has sworn unto thee, if thou wilt keep his commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his way. And all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and thou shalt, and they shall be afraid of thee. And the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods, in the fruit of thy body, in the fruit of thy cattle, in the fruit of thy ground, in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers to give. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure. The heavens shall give the rain unto thy land in his season, to bless all the work of thine hand, and thou shalt lend unto many nations. Sound like giving to missions, that there. Thou shalt lend unto many nations. You say, Bill Carpenter, what are we doing giving to missions? I ain't giving to missions. I'm lending to missions, because I'm going to lend, and it's greater than a bank. I can stand out and say, God, we got to put a new parking lot in, and God will say, I'll just bring some of that back with a little interest. I don't believe you got on. I don't believe you caught on tonight. I don't believe you caught on tonight. I believe you missed the whole thing about why I was just saying that. Because we ought to memorize that. Because we are blessed in the city. We are blessed in the field. If you believe that all of your income, if you believe that God will give you an income to support his work, God will bless your business. Start that new business. Start that new business. If you're going to start that business and you don't have a better home and a better car on your mind, but you got given to the work of God, go ahead and start that mission. Go ahead and start that business, because God is going to bless it. Blessed, blessed. But did you hear? My children are blessed. My children are blessed. A blessing shall overtake thee, an unexpected blessing, because of one crucial thing. I have got the word of God inside me. But wait a minute. Verse 15. I won't read this nowhere near as fast and as exuberant. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not, somebody say not, hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I have commanded thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Where's my blessing coming? Out of nowhere. Where's the blessing coming? It's following me. The blessing comes from behind me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Where's the blessings coming? It's unexpected. They're chasing me. I am a man that's got a marker on me from heaven that God says, he is an obedient servant to my word. Run him down, chase him down, and put a blessing on him. But if I decide not to hearken to God's word and not to obey God's word, look what else comes upon you. Cursed shalt thou be in the city. Cursed shalt thou be in the field. Cursed shall be thy basket and store. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy land, the increase of thy kind and the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke, and all that thou settest thy hand for to do until thou be destroyed, until thou perish quickly, because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me. The Lord shall make the pestilence cleave unto thee, until he hath consumed thee from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. The Lord shall smite thee with consumption and with fever and with inflammation and with extreme burning and with the sword and with blasting and with mildew, and shall pursue thee until thou perish. Don't know about you, but I hope I'm convincing you to get a hold of the word tonight. Thy heaven that is over thy head shall be brass. The earth under thee shall be iron. The Lord shall make the rain of thy land powder and dust. From heaven shall it come down unto thee until thou be destroyed. The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. And thy carcass shall be meat unto all the fowls of the air, unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall fray them away. The Lord shall smite thee with the blotch of Egypt, and with the emerods, and with the scab, and with the itch, and therefore thou shalt not be healed. The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart, and thou shalt grope at noonday as the blind gropeth in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in thy ways, and thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee. Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lay with her. Thou shalt build a house, and another, and shalt not dwell thou in. Thou shalt plant a vineyard and shalt not gather the grapes thereof. Thine ox shall be slain before thine eyes, and thou shalt not eat thereof. Thine ass shall be violently taken away from before thy face, and shall not be restored to thee. Thy sheep shall be given unto thine enemies, and thou shalt none, and they shall be none to rescue them. Thy sons and thy daughters, listen to me tonight, shall be given unto another people. Thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand. The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed away. I could go on and read and read and read and read and read. Surely you got enough mentality tonight to stand on the line of saying, I want to obey the word. What your children don't need is for their daddy to make $40 an hour. Your children need a daddy that'll live for God. What your children need is not for you to feel guilty because you can't give them what they want. What your children need is a mom and dad, even if it's minimum wage, to come in the house of God and worship God and serve God and be obedient to all of God's word. To all of God's word. Would you stand with me right now? Oh, surely tonight there's a healer in this house. There's a healer in this house. Would you pray for a moment right now? Brother Erickson, Brother Nolan, Brother Hammond, Brother Jeter, Brother Ammons, Brother Ambern, Brother Hebert. Would y'all come down around the altar and just walk the altars for a little bit? Would you just come and walk the altars and pray with Pastor for a little bit? Oh, would you just come and walk the altars and pray with Pastor for a little bit? Oh, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes, oh, yes. Oh, God, Alebakasha. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I told you that the Bible, I told you that the altar service would be a little peculiar tonight. I told you it would be a little different tonight. Come on, church, would you pray right now? Would you pray? Oh, would you pray? Oh, Holy Ghost, Lord, I love you, God. I love you, God. You're a healer. Oh, God, you're a healer, God. You're a way maker. Oh, God, I don't believe I have to settle on pastoring a dead church. God, I don't believe that I have to settle that it's the 21st century and people don't get dedicated anymore. I don't believe that I have to pastor a church where people just don't, they just don't travail anymore. They just don't live for God like they did years ago. I just refuse to believe I got to pastor that way. Oh, God. 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 I just don't believe, God, it's your will that we come down to the last closing days of the church and there would be no miracles taking place. There would be no notable miracles taking place, God. God, I don't want you to bring a cripple out of a wheelchair so people could think I'm spiritual. God, I want you to bring cripples out of wheelchairs so that they'll see there's something about this apostolic faith. There's something about the name of Jesus. God, I don't want you to heal stage 5 cancer. So that people think I'm some great spiritual one. God, I want you to heal stage 5 cancer because I want an entire family to say they gave up on daddy, they gave up on mama, but she got healed at that apostolic church. I'm going to start it off with this. Won't you listen to me? To my left. You have a son or a daughter or a grandchild that's a prodigal. I want you to go, but before you move, I want you to speak. Don't you go over. Wait, Brother Abair's going to pray for me. No, I want you to start speaking it. I want you to stand over in that corner and say, my son's coming home. My daughter's coming home. I believe you're speaking to my daughter right now. I believe you're speaking to my son right now. I believe you're going to speak to them right now. My daughter's coming home. I want you to speak it. Yes. Prodigal's over here. It's not the will of God that your child is lost. It's not the will of God that your child is lost right now. Oh, God, touch Chris Perry. Oh, God, touch him right now, God. If you're here tonight, you might need to help me clear the altar. Right here in the middle where Pastor Erickson's at. Right here in the middle, you have got a disease. You are a Kathy Belcher, and you've got a disease. Brother Nolan, get the bottle of oil. You've got a disease that the doctors cannot heal. You've got a disease that they pretty well told you. You've just got to live with it. There's nothing we can do. There is no age limit on healing. There is no age limit on healing. Lord, I want you to heal me. Lord, I want you to heal me. Speak it. Lord, by your stripes I am healed.
church. By your stripes I'm healed. There is no age limit on healing. There is a healer in this house. There is a healer in this house. There is a healer. He's waiting on you to speak it. He's waiting on you to speak it. There is a healer. There is a healer. There is a healer. Come on, speak it. Speak it. Speak it. God, heal me of my diabetes. God, heal me of my diabetes. God, heal me of the cancer. Come on, speak it. By His stripes we are healed. 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 Keep on praying. Look at Pastor way over here on the other side of the platform. If you're in this room tonight and you have an addiction in your life, I know it would take a mighty brave man or a mighty brave woman, but nobody will shame you here. Nobody will shame you if you've got an addiction in your life that you want the chain to be broken. This area right here, I can be set free. I can be set free. I can be set free. God, heal Kim in the name of Jesus. God, heal Kim in the name of Jesus. Right here. Right here. Don't be ashamed, my sister. Don't be ashamed. You're among family tonight. You're among family tonight. Right here, right here, right here, Brother Eric, you're right here. You're among family. You're among family. Come on. Come on. God moves in openness. God moves in openness. Oh, God. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. You're suffering with addiction. It could be a multiplicity of things. For God's sake, come tonight. Come in the presence of God. There's a healer. There's a healer. There's a healer. God, there's a healer in the house. There's a healer in the house. I'm never going to be the same after tonight. I'm going to read the word. I'm going to quote the word. I am the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. I have blessings that are pursuing me. Oh, there's a healer. You hear me? There is a healer here. There is a healer here. Lord, by your stripes I'm healed. By your stripes I'm made whole. God, I repent. God, I repent. God, I've not had the best attitude. God, I've not had the best spirit. God, I've allowed gossip to enter my life. I've allowed ill feelings to enter my life. God, I repent. Come on, church, come on. Repent. Repent, repent. Repent, repent. God, forgive us. God, forgive me. God, if you'll touch me tonight, by the grace of God, by the help of God. Come on, church. I need about 50 men. I need about 50 men tonight that'll pray with all your might. I need about 50 women. I need about 50 women that'll pray right now. Lift your voice like a trumpet. Come on, we're right on the tipping point. We're right on the tipping point. Repentance has taken place. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, men, please pray. Come on, women, please pray. Thank you. Hallelujah. 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 The healer is here. The healer is here. The healer is here tonight. Receive it. There's a healer here tonight. I know I preached longer than usual. And I know I'm holding you longer than usual. But if you just knew the healer is here. If you just knew the healer is here tonight, he's walking the aisles. If you only knew tonight that the word says that we are compassed about with an innumerable number of angels. If you only knew tonight, your strength and deliverance is just a heartfelt worship away.
I
They're going to sing it one more time. They're going to sing it one more time.